thank you very much for the introduction, and well, thank you all for coming to this talk, and to the organizers for the invitation. I'll continue on talking a bit about applying MPS to lattice gauge theories, and I want to explain a couple of things. So basically, I want to comment on the possibility that Karel already mentioned before, that in an open boundary condition system in one plus one dimensions, we can integrate out the gauge degrees of freedom. And actually, the MPS formalism is compatible with doing that, and we have tested this approach. So I will explain how explicitly why this doesn't spoil the advantages of MPSs. And I will explain it first with the model that Karel introduced, the Schwinger model. But then I want to go one step further, still in the one-dimensional easy setting. So one step further in complication towards the ultimate goal of being able to apply these tools to QCD in 3 plus 1 dimensions. So one step further is going to non-abelian theories. And the simplest model we can consider here is SU2. And I will show you how we can combine all these things and apply them also to SU2 and show you some results that we recently got with this model. So I kept here the drawing that Karel first did, so I did it again in the same way, so that you keep in mind that one of the aspects or the ingredients of starting one of these simulations with matrix product states is to find a suitable basis. So we need a tensor product basis of the Hilbert space. Of course, we have to have a well-defined Hilbert space where our problem lives. And then we need to find a tensor product basis. And in this tensor product basis, our ansatz tells us that the wave function we are looking for, the state we are looking for, has coefficients with a particular structure, which is that of a matrix product state tensor network. But well, first we have to choose these bases. And in choosing these bases, we want to do as well as we can to obtain the most efficient representation. And this is somehow what is inside this kind of strategy. So let me start by writing again the Schwinger Hamiltonian, as Karel already presented it. But I, so we didn't coordinate so well in here. I kept the fermionic language in all the expressions because I think they are a bit more compact and easier to understand. Although, to tell you the truth, in our simulations we also use the spin formalism because at the end it's just easier if you have standard MPS tools, although it's perfectly possible to work with fermionic degrees of freedom all the time. So in the fermionic language, or in terms of already discrete fermionic operators, so these fermionic operators that Karel introduced that live on every vertex of the lattice, we had this. This Hamiltonian with the staggered mass term. There are slight differences here because when you think of the spin language, well, the number of fermions is basically sigma z plus 1 divided by 2 or minus 1 divided by 2, and then you have these 1/2 factors and plus 1 or minus 1 going around. But this is basically the same thing you already saw before, where this thing is the electric field, electric flux on every link, and all the rest was already defined before. And we have this plus a constraint, which is Gauss' law, which in this language reads, I think here my notation is a bit different, but okay, I hope that's still okay. So this thing lives on a one-dimensional lattice where we have fermionic and gauge sites. So let me use circles for the fermions. And in between every fermionic site, so every couple of fermionic, every pair of fermionic sites, you have a link variable, so where the gauge lives. And this would be fermions. And Gauss' law connects the values of the gauge variables on both sides of a fermionic side. And well, if we just use this formulation, we can use a basis. So going back to this this first step, the basis we can use can have this structure. Say, let's start numbering the fermionic sides on zero. So we will have a N0 for the occupation number of the first fermionic side, and then let's say L0 because this is like an angular momentum. As well, this is the electric flux here, as Karel already introduced, and so on. And if we have a background field, then this actually is the same as having like a first initial value of the electric flux that comes in the system, but is non-dynamical. So I will just assume it is zero and not write it here. But it wouldn't change anything in the basis because they are like decoupled, completely decoupled sectors. Okay. If we now go back to Gauss' law, as was commented already before, we can use it to solve the value of the electric flux in every link, right? So we can just say from here that the value on a certain link is whatever it was on the link before plus the fermionic content with some offset depending on whether it was a negative or a positive charge that we had in this side. And we can go on and substitute this one in terms of the one before and so on and so on until we arrive to whatever we had as a, say, boundary condition for our system, which I assume is zero. Right? So if I do this, I could just actually write this in terms of this condition, alpha zero plus some sum over all sides, say k smaller or equal than this n here, of c daga k ck minus the corresponding term in here. And well, we can actually pull this out of the sum. This will be proportional to the identity. So here we have a number operator, but this is something proportional to the identity. It will be some constant, which depends on the side. But this is not introducing too many problems in our Hamiltonian. So I'm just concentrating on the problematic terms or the terms that might give rise to some problems. But well, if you're interested in the full expressions, I can show them to you later. Okay, what happens here? If we now substitute this term in this equation, of course, we get rid basically of all the L variables here in terms of whatever fermionic content we have in the rest of the system. But we have the square here of Ln. So we have the square of this sum. And then we will have cross terms of like the number of fermions on one side with the numbers of fermions everywhere else. Basically, so we have long-range couplings now in our Hamiltonian. So it is interesting to see how the structure of this term actually, to see that it is actually not that difficult to deal with. So that in principle, formally, we can plug it in our simulations and continue working with that. Okay, so basically, so I'm not sure. Okay, I didn't say what was the last index in the last fermionic side, but this sum will extend only over links, right? Link variables. So it goes to n minus one if n was my last side. This is not so important here. And then I will have a sum of k and l smaller or equal than n of this. This is just okay. This is not equal. So this will give rise to a term which is like this. K ck. I'm just writing here the terms that are interesting now. Because any other, the identity times something like the number of fermions will give me something which is local in the number of fermions with some constants in front that I can sum over all the ends. Okay, so I actually can make this a bit easier, but by writing that, okay. So restricting the sum basically to k smaller or equal than n and say, L equal to k plus 1, I think this is the easy one, no, L smaller than k, say, from 0 to k minus 1. It doesn't really matter, so these guys commute with each other, so I can just write one term of the sum and look at the structure of this one. And Now this is like k equal to 0 to n, and this only depends on k, but I can actually manipulate the sum of the indices and make the k run for all the possible values, all the links, from 0 to n minus 1, and make the n be just larger than k. Okay? So if I do this here, then I will have a sum over k equal to 0 to n minus 1, and the sum over n equal to k n minus 1. And since nothing here depends on n, this is just a counting of the number of terms that include a given pair of fermionic numbers. So that at the end I get something which looks like, say, k equal to 0 to n minus 1, sum of L, which is smaller than k, of n minus k terms times dckl cl ck, dagger ck, something like that. And actually, I can also play with these indices and make it doesn't really matter so which one I write first. I can focus on what will happen when I arrive to a certain site. And let me explain, because this was not mentioned explicitly before, why this makes it easier or easy for us to work with this.
Is the factor n minus k not l minus k by any chance?
N minus k. N is the total number of sites here. And k is the second one. So this is just a counting, like...
Because I'm confused, because if I were to think in Lagrangian language of integrating out gauge fields, I would just get density-density interaction proportional to x minus y.
Yeah, but this is not what you get here, because this is just counting. So this is a term, okay.
But is this procedure analogous or equivalent to integrating out gauge field, or is it something else?
No, it's the same thing. I don't know how you translate it in one with the other. But I mean, we can look at the expressions in more detail later. But it's basically the same thing. I'm not doing anything else here but integrating Gauss' law. Only I'm doing it in the discrete formulation and already writing it in terms of the fermions. So if you want to understand what this means, this is like in the Hamiltonian, I will have a term that has a product of the sum of all fermionic occupations for all sites, say, from k or l equal 0 to k minus 1 of nl times nk. And this term appears more and more times if I go farther to the right, because every time I include all the sum of all the terms to the left. So, okay? And the factor in front is just how many times this appears, depending on, okay. So I said, so every time I go here, I include more terms, but this term, appears in all the terms that are to the right of it, so more and more terms. Is this clear? More or less? I mean, what this means?
It's clear how you do the computation, but it's not, what is not clear is why it does not agree with the intuition.
Okay. I need to see the expressions to see if I understand, because these are not the ones for which I have an intuition for. So the only thing I want to argue here is that these kind of terms, so this factor depends only on the second term here, so I can just group it with this operator, and then I have something which is a sum of local operators to the left, and then this operator. So when I'm computing the expectation value of the Hamiltonian, as Karel was showing before, I can easily do like local terms. And each of these terms in the sum would be something where in my MPS, I have something like this, say this is my MPS. And now I have this kind of two-body correlation, so I have to put one operator here and one operator there. And I have the same contraction. But if I'm, so this is something that I can contract efficiently. So say that I want to optimize this tensor, so I want to contract everything from here to there, or even without thinking of the optimization, say that I want to compute the expectation value of this guy. So I can compute this contraction, then sum the contraction with the other term here and the other term there, and so on. But what I can do is I can start here and compute the contraction of the identity, and the contraction of the operator here. Then I move on, right? I keep these two contractions independently. So I move on, and for this one I can add another identity. Or I can compute the contraction of one operator here. And for this one, because I already included the operator, I can just put the identity. Okay, so now I could sum these two, because these are part of this operator. So these two are just two vectors of this generic form that Karel was using before. And I only need to keep these two terms in here. And I can move on in the same way. So there are systematic ways of taking care of this in the whole Hamiltonian. But the important thing in here is that for all this sum, I don't need to count what is the distance between this and this other side. Because at the end, when I put the last operator, I will just include the proper counting number, counting factor. Okay? So this means that I have a very efficient way of dealing with these long range terms in the formulation. It doesn't tell you immediately that the MPS will be good, because now we have a Hamiltonian which is non-local anyway. Right? This is another. Yes.
Is what you just said equivalent to saying that there is a very compact matrix product operator representation of this Hamiltonian?
Yes, one dimension five, I think. So it's only adding one with respect to the one of the Swinger model.
And if you were to use matrix product states that explicitly preserve U1 symmetry, would you be able to read this number from the bond index directly, not have to?
That's the thing, that we are removing completely the value of the electric flux from the picture. So we are just working in the physical subspace. And we can recover. DL, I'm showing it to you exactly right now.
What I'm saying is that this operator that you are measuring, so it's the product of, you first sum the particle number, fermionic particle number, from the left to whatever position you are in.
Mm-hmm.
And then you do you have some number operator
yes.
on the next side. So, but this information, you could codify it in the matrix product state bond index. If you preserve U1 symmetry explicitly in the bond index.
Okay, but this is in the Hamiltonian, okay? This is part of the Hamiltonian. I'm still not talking about what the representation of the MPS
I know,
is.
I know, but what I'm saying is that if you eventually will use a matrix product state to represent the wave function, you could read such information.
Absolutely, yes. Yes, we actually do that in some cases when we need it. Only for what I'm telling you now, I think you don't need it at all. But what I'm telling you exactly now is how you connect. So, okay, let me just give you the intermediate steps that I wanted to mention. So if we do that, we can eliminate all the L's from the picture. So we can reduce our basis to just the physical, so just the matter content, if you want. Because the Hamiltonian only connects states with the valid electric flux in between. And now we know how it connects it, because we can write this term in terms of the fermionic content only. So now we have a Hamiltonian which only lives on this fermionic degrees of freedom. And actually this is the physical subspace, because we have eliminated any gauge degrees of freedom, which are non-physical. If we want to go back, if we want to recover what the electric flux is in a link, we can actually do it nicely from the MPS kind of mindset. In terms of local isometries, basically. So the idea is that if we know, say for a, if we have a state, okay, let me just state. We know the fermionic content on one side and the electric flux on the link before, the only thing we need to do is to sum them, right? So we can just write an isometry which maps some value of the electric flux and value of the fermion content and recovers the next electric flux in the next link. And this will be just according to Gauss' law. And here I just need to pass on the value of the electric flux. And of course I can concatenate all these things so that if I have an MPS in the physical subspace, which has some nice MPS structure, I can just, well, because I said now I'm considering that the background is zero, so I can just start from this thing here and just reconstruct what the electric flux is on every link. So in this link it will be that, and then in the next one something else, and so on. And well, the last one doesn't really matter. It's again not non-dynamical. Okay, so I could just write this thing, and this thing is just an isometry which recovers the value of the electric flux from before. And what this thing tells you is that if this matrix product state in the I'm saying if, so I still didn't show that this needs to be the case. But if this MPS in the physical subspace was a good MPS, so was a good approximation to whatever states we are interested in with a small bond dimension, when I'm applying this isometry here, well, I can again write an MPS in the full basis before. If I interpret as tensors of the MPS, everything contracted, so I flatten it and just contract all these tensors together. And then the dimensions of these tensors in general would be up to the product of the dimension I had, the bond dimension I had before, and whatever this isometry is introducing. And what this isometry is introducing will be given by the value of this electric flux, because I'm just passing the electric flux on. So I need to include as many states for this isometry as values of the electric flux I need to keep. And what Karel showed actually at the end of his talk in his results, and what we intuitively expect, is that for low energy states at least, we don't have contributions where the electric flux on one link is extremely high. The value of the electric flux or the contribution of these sectors decays pretty fast. So that's somehow the argument why this thing, even though it's non-local, well, it still has all the ingredients to be a good way to deal with the problem. Okay, so it makes sense to look at it. So actually, we did that for the Zwinger model with this formalism and got pretty good results. You can also use it for a generalization of the Zwinger model where you include several flavors. And this gives you access to like the simplest situation in which Monte Carlo calculations have a signed problem, even in 1D. If you put several flavors and you allow them a different chemical potential for the different flavors, in principle, the Monte Carlo calculations are already finding in the general case. I mean, there are some specific parameters where they don't, but in the general case, they will have a same problem. Yes?
So I have a question maybe for Svan, actually, because in the end, I sympathize, well, that you want to do this to learn how to go to higher dimensions, but specifically for one-dimensional systems, is it correct that in the Lagrangian formalism, you can integrate out the gauge degrees of freedom and end up with a local model? Is that true?
No, it's not going to be local.
It's not local.
It's going to be non-local potential.
Even in one dimension.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
In higher dimensions, in general, you can't integrate all the gauge degrees of freedom. Not all of them are redundant, if you want, or spurious in terms of just given by the Gauss.
But in one dimension, even after integrating, you lose locality.
Okay.
And the other question was, so what goes wrong if you do periodic boundary conditions? I'm assuming that what you said in one dimension with open boundary condition generalizes to three structures.
You can do something, but not everything. For instance, one problem that you have is that the background field that I wrote in here is not a background field anymore. You have one value of one link, which is dynamical, because your Hamiltonian can induce changes of this value. And
you have a sum of a possible
value. Exactly. Then you would need to keep, like, for instance, sectors for this value of L, at least for one side.
But that would be the whole complexity. The extra complexity would be a linear combination of possibilities.
You would need to keep all these values, yes. Now, how you do it in practice, you would need to figure it out, I guess. Okay. So
are you saying that if you learn to simulate this model at zero chemical potential, then adding chemical potential is very easy?
To this one?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. To this one, it doesn't give you anything because it basically... Okay, here we were always looking... I didn't mention this. So this is the physical subspace, but it includes different states with different net charge. So you can have states with different net charge. If you focus on charge zero states, and then you add a chemical potential, it moves like all the charge sectors together, if you want. So it doesn't really change anything. But if you include different flavors, then you can have some effects. Then you will have that for some values of the chemical potential, you have a phase transition in the ground state, where you create an imbalance of the two flavors. And this thing you can observe with these tools and compare. So there are analytical results for the massless fermionic case, it's a bit like in the Schwinger, so the normal Schwinger model for the massless, so for the massless fermions, it has an exact solution, so you can always compare to that. For massive fermions, you don't have exact solutions, but you can do the same calculations. So I'm not planning on showing you the results, but if you're interested, I can show them later. Okay?
So you said you have only fermionic variables, but you haven't looked at high theta and so.
No, what I mentioned is, because I didn't do it explicitly, but what I'm saying is that, okay, one way, or the simplest way probably to see this, is that if I now take the physical basis, I can compute the action of the Hamiltonian in this physical basis. The Hamiltonian only connects states in the physical basis with the physical basis. So it never takes you out of that because it's gauge invariant, of course. So in the physical basis, it doesn't.
This e to the I theta, which is still in your Hamiltonian.
Well, I mean, formally, you can actually apply a transformation, redefine your fermions to absorb it.
Okay.
That's if you want to do it formally. So the most intuitive picture is that you can compute the matrix elements of your Hamiltonian in the physical basis, compute an effective Hamiltonian there,
mm-hmm.
and it's just not doing anything because it's just the physical basis, and the Hamiltonian doesn't take you out of that.
You can also see this as attaching a Wilson line.
Yes, yes, exactly. That's the transformation you would do to the fermions to remove it. Okay, so I want to do the same thing now for the non-abelian case. So this trick is known, of course, very well known for the Schwinger model. It has been used for all strong coupling expansion calculations and other numerical calculations in the Hamiltonian picture. I think it was not so much used for non-abelian cases, although it's known in principle that also in a non-abelian case, the gauge degrees of freedom are non-dynamical, they are not independent in a 1 plus 1 theory. It's not so clear how to use this in practice to reduce the complexity of your calculation. So I'm going to show you one way of doing it. I'm not telling you it's the only one, but it has some nice properties, and we actually can use it to like boost the possibilities of MPSs, at least to solve this kind of model. Because if we reduce the number of degrees of freedom, we reduce the cost of all our calculations, and we can push the simulations farther and explore farther the physics of the model. Okay, so to move to a SU2 Hamiltonian, so we also use the Kogut-Sasking SU2 lattice gauge theory, the Hamiltonian formulation, and the only thing that changes here is that instead of having, say, in the Schwinger model, we had this hopping term with the link variable in between that takes care of the gauge invariance. Well, now this has to be generalized to some link variable, which I call U now, which is now an SU2 matrix. Actually, it's an operator valued matrix when we are considering the quantum model. And this takes care of the proper transformation, so that if under a gauge transformation, the fermionic operator transforms as some V, say, then the link has to take care of the left and the right transformations to keep the Hamiltonian invariant, right? So this is the basis of Kogut-Saskin's and Saskin's construction. So, okay. So basically, in this picture I had before of my system, so my lattice, so I have fermions, gauge, and so on. When I apply a gauge transformation, you can think of it of applied to a vertex site. And it has to affect the fermion and the adjacent links in the proper way. So one can introduce the generators of left and right transformations of the link variable, and this can be called LARA for left and right. These guys have to satisfy SU2. commutation relations, and the same thing for R, for similar, well, you have some freedom here, and they commute with each other. And they have to transform you in the right way. So this gives you the transformation. Okay, this is just for one link. Okay, I'm not writing explicitly the n indices everywhere, but of course all these guys are defined for every link. Okay, so this is just to show you what is. So maybe I should tell you where I'm going with this. I'm just going to write what is the proper basis to start studying the Hamiltonian in the SU2 case, so that you can see how things get more complicated when we go to the simplest non-abelian case. Okay, so this guy has to, let me just write like this, to have the proper, so they have to generate the proper transformations of U under an SU2 transformation on the left and on the right. So this basically tells you that this one gives you the same thing on the right. And they actually are not independent, so the U transforms one in the other. So this is Code and Saskin's representation, formulation of this of the Hilbert space of a link. Of the, yeah, exactly, Hilbert space of a link in the Gates theory by analogy to a quantum solid rotor, rigid rotor. Okay, so what you can apply two independent rotations on the left and on the right, and this would be generated by two angular momentum kind of objects. So I didn't write here that these indices, this is SU2. I'm thinking of them just as x, y, z for the three components of the angular momentum. Okay, so this L here or R here are so the chromo electric field. Now, so they are the analogous or the generalization, if you want, of the relations that Karel wrote before for the U1 case. And the natural choice for the electrostatic energy term or chromo electrostatic energy term is the Casimir of these guys, which is just LA squared, which is the same. And this is, let's call it J squared. Okay, so with all these ingredients, the Hilbert space of the link, or a basis for the Hilbert space of the link, can be chosen or specified by three quantum numbers. One of them will be the total angular momentum of this rigid rotor, which is the quantum number associated to this operator J squared. So that J squared acting on this guy is J plus one, oops, M prime. And then the other two quantum numbers are the third components of the corresponding left and right generators of the exactly of the corresponding rotation. So LZ, J, M, this is M, and RZ is the M prime. M prime. Okay, so now we have a...
So I'm a bit confused. You have, so I can think of this U variable as just living on the group.
Mm-hmm.
So this U operator is just an operator which acts on the functions of the group in the coordinate representation. And then these L's and R's are just some vector fields on the group, invariant vector fields.
But they are operators that act on the
yeah, of course, field a vector field acting on the space of functions is an operator. And now you're just saying that you are going to expand these functions in this basis J, M, M prime. But I don't understand why you need both M and M prime indices. Wouldn't it be enough to have just one index and still have a full space of functions?
So I'm not so familiar with your language, but you need to have two independent, the ability to independently rotate. So I'm talking about what is the Hilbert space of the link, okay?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
And for this you need to have two different independent sets of rotations.
In this basis?
Okay, U now, as I said, is an SU2, is an SU2 matrix, so it has indices. Okay, it has like color indices for one, say, L prime. Let's call it L prime for one link. Okay, and it corresponds, it carries, if you want, an angular momentum 1/2. So when this guy acts on J M prime, this gives you J plus 1/2 M plus L M prime plus L prime with a coefficient, and it gives you J minus 1/2 M plus L M prime plus L prime. With, and these coefficients are just the product of Clebsch-Gordan coefficients to get you the right composition of angular momenta. And with this you have all the ingredients you need to now know how to write this this Hamiltonian in these bases, or use these bases to explore this Hamiltonian. Okay, this is just for one link, and now the bases for your whole Hilbert space can be written as, okay, I still need to tell you how you represent the fermions for that. Okay, so, okay, maybe I should actually, yeah, this is not so good. Maybe this was not such a good idea, not the right order. Okay, I think this one we can just remove. Yeah, maybe I don't completely press recycle. So what I was saying is that instead of having this, now I have a link variable like that, and instead of having the electric flux here, now I have this JN square. And these guys have these color indices that I wrote before explicitly, L prime, and L here, which will be some. So the fermions now have two components. So each of the fermions, before we had like a spinless fermions per side, now we have a spinor, which will be, for instance, I can call it plus and minus using spin 1/2 language, or I could call them red and green if I want to make reference to two colors in the theory. So this is what I have now as degrees of freedom for the matter sides, or the fermionic sides, with proper anti-commutation relations and so on. And okay. And Gauss law now is non-abelian, so it has three components, okay, that do not commute among themselves. So I can write them in this way. So the signs are not exactly the same ones we were using before for the Schwinger, but it means exactly the same thing, right? That the right generators here are constrained to whatever were the, sorry, the left generators here are constrained, so left, because it's the left of the link, okay? So it's the left for this link, it's constrained by whatever the right was for the incoming link and the fermionic content. And the fermionic color charge, this thing, is just, say, C daga n sigma a half cn, okay? This operator. So this is the color charge carried by whatever content I have in the fermionic side. So one of the difficulties is that now this thing has three components, and we would need to impose that for any of them on the physical states. This is well defined, so I could in general write a number here that represents an external charge distribution, so I can put some external charges, and this is useful for some of the simulations we have done. But if there's no external charge, then I can just put them to zero, as was done before, and I need to ensure that these three components are zero. Okay, so what is the basis now for my MPLs? Doing the same as before, right, like the fermionic content. So for every fermionic site here, I could just write a basis saying what is the number of plus and the number of minus components, right, the occupation number of both fermionic fields, or I can equivalently say what is the number of fermions I have in the site and what is the color third component that they are carrying. And this is just, say, n plus plus n minus, and this guy is n minus divided by 2. It has the same information, and it's just more useful, I think, to see what I'm doing next to use this representation. Because at the end, what we want is to exploit the fact that we are composing the angular momenta corresponding to each of the links to get back the full basis or to reduce it as much as possible. Okay.
Yes. I may have missed when you said that, but on each side, are you still in the staggered formulation?
Yes, sorry, I didn't say it because I just started from here. Right. Yes, yes.
So what are these two?
So for each component of the original spinor, now you have two additional, one additional index, which is a color.
Staggering corresponds to positrons.
Yes, yes, but you can put, say, the positron for red and green on one side, and in the next one you will have the electron for red and green. That's what we are doing. Okay, so the basis, just to write it once, it would be something like N0, and then I put a link, so it will be J0, M0, M0 prime, and then I will have another N1, S1, and J1, M1, M1 prime, and so on. So this could be a product basis, so we are here, and now we could, in principle, start thinking of writing the MPS simulation. But this is, of course, still not enough, because this guy is unbounded. This takes values from, so, positive semi-integers, so 0, 1 half, 1, 3 halves, and so on, but it is in principle unbounded. So it has infinite dimension per link. And we cannot work with this directly with an MPS. So again, we want to truncate. And the easiest way to truncate here is actually to truncate the representations we allow for this J. So if you truncate including full representations, so for one half you include all the possible values of M and M prime and so on, what you end up having is an SU2 invariant model, only it's truncated, of course, it's not the full story. This was introduced, I think, by Eres Zohar and Michele Burrello first with the idea of using this to propose a quantum simulation procedure so that you could realize the operators that appear in there with atoms in an optical lattice, basically, with operations that you can apply with to them. And then they actually have a proposal with that. It's not the only way to truncate the model to get an gauge invariant thing, and it's not the only way to work with gauge invariant MPSs or more general tensor networks. But in this case, it's just the simplest way because you have these bases, you truncate the bases, but you do it in a way that your model keeps the symmetry.
Keeping symmetry is important, but in the end, is this a good truncation or not?
Well, that's the thing, right? So it's a good truncation in the sense that it's better than killing the symmetry with your truncation, which you could in principle do. Okay.
But is the ground state supported on many representations that you are throwing away?
I will show you some results at the end that compare how much it changes. Things change when you include more and more representations.
So that means that it's a good truncation or not?
It's good. Yeah, it's good if you include enough representations, of course. But I'm commenting now on the cost of including more and more representations. Because, okay, with what Karel was showing before, you were doing exactly the same thing, right? So you're including more and more values of L, and then he was showing explicitly that with, I don't know, 6, 7 values of L, you have enough. But in here, including 7 different values of J is very costly. Because if you think of truncating this to some J max, the dimension you have per link will be the sum of 2j plus 1 squared. So 2j plus 1 squared is the dimension for a given representation.
Right. I can feel pity for the person who will have to implement this. But yes. In the end, this is a good truncation scheme.
It is a good truncation scheme. Yeah, yeah. No. Okay, I didn't understand your question. It's a good truncation in this
so
sense.
Why is it that as j increases, the weight of the wave function is suppressed?
Well, I think it's basically similar. I mean, I don't have a very, very clear intuition for this SU2 model, but it's basically the same phenomenon that happens in the Zwinger model, right? You expect that the screening doesn't let you have like huge contributions of like very large fields in between, right? So Askian is the same, but with all the non-abelian setting.
Solid.
Maybe also just look at the third term in the Hamiltonian there. So there we have basically sum of Casimir squared.
So it's suppressing it.
So this is one effect. This is one term effect.
Well, they could appear anyway in the dynamics, right? Also in the Zwinger model it happens that if you look at out of equilibrium dynamics, then maybe this is not the best way to proceed. And this is what Florian Hebenstreit showed in some cases, no? That they had contributions from very large L values for some out of equilibrium situations. But I guess for low energy states, you would expect that it is good or a good strategy, say. Okay, so how costly is this? Well. If your J max is 1/2, which is the first non-trivial.
I also have a question about this. So this last term in the Hamiltonian, it also depends on the lattice spacing. Should I think that if I approach the continuum limit and the fluctuations of this J are more and more suppressed, so I could always achieve? You know, how does the distribution of J change when you approach the continuum limit? Does it become more and more peaked at small values of J?
Okay, that's a good question. We didn't look at that explicitly. We looked at continuum limits, and we found that things converge well with the small values of J, but we didn't look explicitly at whether for different values of the lattice spacing the relative weights change a lot. So I don't know.
In the continuum limit, you would take A to zero with G. So is this coupling being suppressed or enhanced?
No, in the continuum limit, you approach, in principle, the ultraviolet fixed point, so all fluctuations are going to be controlled by that fixed point, so you know what they are. So you could use it.
Yeah, but
in the model, in the continuum limit, you take AG going to zero, right? Because this is the adimensional lattice. And what happens is that this coefficient goes to infinity.
So then this energetic suppression of large J is not necessarily dominant. So it potentially you could have large fluctuations in the J's. Potentially. Maybe there's some mechanism that says that's not happening.
So I told you we didn't look explicitly at the dependence on the on the lattice spacing of these things. What we observed was that the continuum limit converges pretty well with very small values of the J max. If you want.
The question I'm asking, which is relevant to assess how this is going to work in the continuum limit, is a question that has nothing to do with MPS, right? It's a question of maybe the answer is no about this. In the continuum limit, are there significant fluctuations of J? Is this known? Do you know if this is known? I'm looking at
No. I don't usually think about this in the Hamiltonian language.
I see. So then the MPS answer is well, it's a question that maybe it's very relevant to assessing whether these simulations will work, but it's also a question that has not been asked before.
So for the case of QED with the electric field squared, a similar issue. So we really looked at this pushing A to zero and see whether we needed, let's say, a broader truncation, and actually we didn't. So this seems to work well as well in the continuum limit.
Right. Which is great news, but is there any intuition why that's not true?
Maybe we should conversation off until at the end of the talk. So
I think it's like 10 minutes, no? Yeah, since I. Yeah, so I should start wrapping up because I still wanted to show you and I didn't show you how to integrate out the gauge degrees of freedom still. Okay, so this was just to count dimensions, right? So like the smallest non-trivial truncation you could have in here gives you a physical dimension of 5 in the link variable, which is okay. It's more expensive than the 2 we had before for the fermions, but it's still okay. But then if you add 1, then you have to add 3 squared, right? So you have 14. And if you want to have 3/2, you are already 30, and then you go to 55, and so on. So this grows pretty fast. And in practice, it means that you really cannot explore this question exactly that was discussed now, very efficiently with these tools because your computation doesn't allow it. Anyway, we did some simulations when we started this project. We did some simulations with these ideas of, okay, this would be useful for quantum simulators and so on. This formulation with the smallest non-trivial truncation. And this already gives some interesting results and allows us to explore, for instance, how to construct observables that would allow one to observe string breaking. So, or to characterize this happening in this Hamiltonian picture, if one would do this, for instance, in a lab, you would like to know what observables to measure to have your quantum simulators saying that you are effectively seeing string breaking or not. Okay, but this is not something I'm showing now because I just want to very fast tell you the couple of things that you can do in here to still use the MPS to get some more information about all these things. So the first idea is quite simple and is that, well, here you have, of course, too many degrees of freedom. So all these color indices are not arbitrary, if you want, in physical states. Your physical states are only going to be a color singlet, right? And the Hamiltonian, the operators that you are applying in there, is only changing from a color singlet to a color singlet. So in principle, you could just have one representative for a color singlet possibility of all these fermionic occupations and J values. And this already reduces your complexity quite a lot. So okay, let me just do it here. And the idea is that, so if we start with a, okay, should I start here? Yeah, okay. If we start, so this was introduced by Hamer already in 82. So he used this for some strong coupling calculations. And so the way he was doing it is starting from the strong coupling vacuum, which would be, say, 0, 0, 0 fermions, and no, so of course, no S here, 0 flux. And then because it's a staggered formulation on the positron sides, if you want, you have the Dirac C occupied. So you will have 0 here, and so on. Well, you just need a representative, which in this case is just the same state. So you just need to indicate the n, the j, the n, and the j, and so on. Okay. And now your Hamiltonian is only connecting singlet states to singlet states. So you can just write in general this for the representative of the corresponding sum, where all the third components are summed properly, and you include the proper normalization factors. I'm not writing the full story here. The idea would be, for instance, that if you have something like 1, 1 half, 1, where this 1 half is the j, right? This is basically a sum of, say, 1 s, j s, s prime, 1 s prime. Over s and s prime equal plus and minus 1/2 and so on, right? So you can just write this thing. And you can just compute which transitions the Hamiltonian allows and write the effective Hamiltonian in these bases. And for instance, so I'm not writing the explicit transformations, but say, for instance, you could have, say, 0 flux, zero fer- oops. Okay, need another one. 0 fermions, 2 fermions, and then say you have no flux, no flux. You can have a hopping between these two sides, which would give you 1, 1. I would include here a 1/2 flux. And in general, if this was j, 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 of course, because this is 0, the Gauss law implies that this has to be the same j as was here. So this is the only possibility. You have 0, 2 here. Here you could have j, j plus minus 1/2 j. And you can compute just the matrix elements of the Hamiltonian in this basis. So you can actually write an effective Hamiltonian in this basis, which is already less costly than the one we had before, because the dimension of the link now is just the number of values of j you need to keep. Right? So in this case, it would be like 2, 3, 4, and so on. So this is already a big advantage if you want to do these simulations. But of course, it's not the whole story, because even though here you have these two possibilities, this is the only sort of indeterminacy you have. If you know all the fermionic content, you know that there will be a component which has, say, if you, when you have one fermion, will be the J plus 1/2, and another component that will be the J minus 1/2. So you can actually include this information in the fermionic, in the vertex Hilbert space, and define a basis for the fermions, which is, say, we had the 0, 1, 2 basis. So now we can just write a basis like this. See that the only thing we are trying to do here is to have an efficient representation of the physical subspace, to remove all the degrees of freedom that we don't want to deal with, so that in this basis we will then put the MPS ansatz, and then we can do the numerics more efficiently. And so if we call this index, say, n with a hat, okay, then we can just write a basis which just has this vertex degrees of freedom. And now, of course, the dimension of these bases is 4 to the n, because again, we have dimension 4 precise. So I didn't say it before, in this reduced singlet basis, the dimension of the vertex is just 3, because you just have to say how many fermions there are, 0, 1, or 2. Now we are back to 4 per vertex, but we don't have any extra link variables. And okay, Gauss' law in these bases was exactly this, that for 0 and 2 fermions, J on the right is the same as J on the left, and for one fermion is plus minus 1/2, so these two possibilities. Now Gauss' law has been completely abelianized, if you want, so of course we don't have it explicitly, but the relation, if we want to recover the J content as before, is that Jn is just a sum of k smaller or equal than n of some local operator, which I call qk, which is just how many 1 plus or 1 minus fermionic sides we find, right? So this would be the k on k side, k smaller than n. Okay? And well, that's basically it. So this you can use to do the simulations. And I will just show you, like in the last 2 minutes, some example results.
So this brings you again to the non-local Hamiltonian.
Ah, yes, yes, of course. Yeah, I didn't see. Yeah. So the form of this thing is completely analogous to the one in the Schwinger model. So all the things that I argued before, that this is not really so increasing so much the complexity of the simulation, applies the same. There is a caveat though, or a difference, because I didn't show you the matrix elements of the Hamiltonian in these bases, which somehow is inherited by these bases too, is that the hopping depends on the values of j prime. So there is a non-local component to the hopping now, but it's sort of easy to take care of because of this structure that it has, which is again similar to the one I showed before, that gives you this isometry which just carries or counts the value of the J on the link. And actually we didn't do this, but it would be very nice to combine this now with the abelian symmetry in the tensors, like the one that Karel was using, because that would simplify actually dealing with these hopping terms, I would say. We didn't do that explicitly, so we could do the simulations without including that. But, okay. So, okay, this is the basis I showed. This is the explicit form of the isometry that I was mentioning now, that maps from one thing to the other. It's actually very simple, so it looks horrible with so many indices, but it's actually very simple because the only thing you are doing is, if you know this fermionic content or like decorated fermionic content on the side, and you know what the J was on the link before, you can reconstruct all the third components that were missing with the proper Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. So it's actually very, very natural, and it's only ugly to be written in that way. So again, the MPS, if you have an MPS in the reduced basis, which is what we are computing, you can just transform it back to the full basis, and you can recover anything you wanted in there. So one of the things we looked at was entropies. I'm not talking about that here, but it was important to understand the structure of these isometries precisely to be able to relate entropies in a safe way. So I'm just showing you spectral properties here, and this is already after the continuum limit has been taken. So I'm not showing you all the intermediate steps you need to do to find the continuum result, because okay, the goal of this project from the very beginning, we were collaborating, I didn't say it before, this is a collaboration with Stefan Kuhn, who was a student in our group, and Ignacio Cirac, of course, and then with Carl Janssen and Christoph Tschichy, who are lattice QCD experts. So they work on lattice QCD, and the idea was to do the calculations like in a very systematic way, to go to extract continuum results for this theory, if we start with a lattice formulation. And so this is actually the results for the energy density of the ground state for different values of the truncation of this maximum J in the link. Okay, and here what I'm showing here is not actually the energy density, it's actually compared to the full model, which in this case was okay, let me see. Okay, yeah, exactly. For this case, there was an exact solution. Okay, so what you can see here is what I was saying before, even for the very small truncation, J max equal 1/2. Okay, the ground state energy is pretty good. So the error is 10^-2. This is already quite good because it's after all the extrapolations we had to do. Okay, it gets better if you increase the J max, but it doesn't seem so bad, which is sort of good news if you want for people thinking of quantum simulating this thing, because in a quantum simulator, necessarily, if you do these simulations with local terms and so on, you will have very small dimension of the degrees of freedom you can manipulate per link. Okay, and if we go one step further, we also want to compute the spectrum of the theory, we compute the mass gap. So this is the mass of the vector meson, so the first particle in the theory. Again, we have, okay, does this work? Yes. Yes. So again, I'm showing here the results for different truncations. Okay, let me just show you the result at the end. And this is the gap that you obtain for different values of the bare mass fermion if the truncation is at 1/2, so the simplest one, which is non-trivial. And you see that in this case, well, the values differ more considerably than before, but not only that, so the theory becomes massless when the mass of the fermion goes to zero. So here we can extract actually the critical exponent of this, the closing of this gap. And if we do this for the different truncations, we see that that things differ. So here the errors are estimated after all our extrapolations, and the worst one, the one that is less controlled, is actually the continuum extrapolation. And it turns out that for J max equal 1/2, this one is not even a reliable extrapolation at all. If you do these fits and you want to extract the continuum limit, your chi-squares tell you that these fits are not really very reliable. So this is why we don't show here some errors, because it seems that these fits are not really working, which is sort of consistent because it's not necessary that that this theory truncated to J max equal 1/2 has the continuum limit of the full SU2 theory, not at all. Okay, but it's still nice to see how things depend on the J max, because it's also reason to push the simulations to larger J max, or to tell the quantum simulators in the lab to do this or not.
The stars are the lattice results.
Ah, okay. So all these are lattice results. These are results, I think, from a strong coupling expansion from an earlier Hamer's paper. I will check the reference, but I think it's that paper that I was mentioning before. Oh, okay. And I think the entropies I'm not showing here, so because I'm already over time. But this is also something interesting that we can. Okay, maybe I just show you the picture and that's it. So the entropy in this case is interesting too. The entropy in a gauge in a gauge theory, it can be calculated because, as Karel mentioned, you have very easy access to the entropy in the MPS, and actually you expect this kind of divergence in the continuum. So we can actually extract these central charges, the same as Karel was mentioning, and again this is again, here is some place where you see very clear differences if your truncation is very small. I'm not commenting very much on the details of this thing here, but and this depends also on the mass of the fermion. But I think I'll just stop here because I'm already over time. So thank you for your attention.
Do we have any quick questions for come on?
I got confused. I thought you integrated out the gauge states, so so you didn't have to do any truncation.
Okay, in practice, we could not do it, but it's more costly because we have this dependence on the hopping on the J value. So the J value we can always reconstruct, but this cost grows linearly with the system size. So because here we are taking system sizes of several hundred sites, we don't want to keep all possible values. So what we do is systematically we keep more and more and see when things converge, and when this is enough, we stop the simulations. We are still truncating. There would be ways of pushing this further or doing the integration of the gauge degrees of freedom in a different way, but not with this abelianized theory, I guess.
Other questions? Let's thank Marie Carmen again.
Thank you.